Okay, so the next few problems are just going to be random things dealing with fractions. Now that you know a little bit on how to calculate with fractions, we've gone over adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing fractions, simplifying them. You need to be aware of how you might see them in a problem, whether you're evaluating one, solving one, just different things. So the next few examples are just going to be a few just different random examples dealing with a problem that might have a fraction thrown in there. All right, so the first thing we have here, so this is the formula for converting temperature to Celsius, right? So that formula is this one here. So Celsius is equal to 5/9 times whatever the Fahrenheit temperature is minus 32. So for this particular example, we're given that the Fahrenheit is 86 degrees. So essentially what we're doing is, if it's 86 degrees Fahrenheit, what is it Celsius, right? So actually calculating this algebraically using the formula. All right, so this is what I call a plug and chug problem. You're given the formula, you're given the number to plug into it. So what we're gonna do with this example here is we're gonna take our number, we're gonna plug it into the formula, and we're gonna chug away, right? So step one, make sure that when you are plugging in, that when you're substituting into the formula, you are literally substituting in directly into the formula. Nothing changes except for the fact that instead of the F, we now have an 86. Everything else needs to stay the same. Don't change anything. No signs, no parentheses, nothing. Everything stays the same. So step one, make sure that you plug it in directly into the problem and make sure that everything else stays the same. Step two, make sure that you use your order of operations in order to simplify down this problem. Now, when you're simplifying down a formula, an expression, just anything where you have to do some calculating, some simplifying to it, you need to make sure that you follow the order of operations in order to do it, right? So order of operations, right, PEMDAS, or please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. A lot of us has heard of this. We've worked with it maybe before, but I do understand there's a lot going on. There's some equations that can get pretty lengthy, and it can be a little difficult to figure out what do we do first when it comes to these. All right, so anytime you do have parentheses in a problem, P stands for parentheses, you always do that first. Once that's out of the way, you then work on exponents. You then work on multiplication and division next. Those go hand in hand. You pretty much treat them as if they're the same calculation. Just make sure that you take care of it in order from left to right in your problem. Same thing with addition and subtraction. Those always go last, but you take care of them in order from left to right for your problem. So once you plug in and you now have a problem that you need to simplify down, I always say, look over the problem. Assess what is going on. What do you have for that particular problem? All right, so here I have 5/9 times. Do understand that this is a multiplication. 5/9 times whatever is inside here. So I do have parentheses, and inside those parentheses, I have a subtraction symbol. So according to my order of operations, parentheses always comes first. Anytime you see parentheses in any problem, it always comes first. So I have parentheses here. I need to take care of that first. So this here is a subtraction. So my first step for this problem is to simplify this subtraction here. So 86 minus a 32, well, 86 minus 32 is 54. Drop down the rest of the problem. There were parentheses, and this 5/9 was getting multiplied to that. Now, after taking care of that subtraction, there's really only a multiplication left here. Do realize the difference between parentheses as far as this is concerned. Once you simplify that down and you are only left with one single factor inside the parentheses, this is now just multiplication. There's nothing left to do inside those parentheses, so it's just a matter of taking 5/9 times the 54. Now, always remember that when it does come to multiplying a fraction times a whole number, I always, always, always recommend put that whole number over a 1 just so that you have a numerator and a denominator for each number there. It just kind of makes it a little clearer on what you're doing. Otherwise, multiplying fractions is straight across. So 54 times 5 is 270 over 9 times 1, which is a 9. All right, so the only thing left to do here is to simplify. So the first thing I would do here is to check to see, does 270 divided by 9 evenly? And actually, it does. 9 goes into 270 30 times perfectly. If it did not, we would just simplify this here. We are talking about temperature. So for the most part, when we're talking about temperature, they do want it left as a decimal. So it would just depend on the problem. If the problem does tell you to round to the nearest degree or anything like that, I would definitely pay attention to that. This one happens to divide out evenly. So here, 86 degrees Fahrenheit is 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, so here are a couple of examples where we might need to translate. So throughout different algebra books, there are just sporadically these translate problems just thrown in throughout different sections. And for the most part, these problems here, they're kind of like word puzzles. They have a sentence or two, and you're expected to read the sentence and be able to translate it into an expression, an equation, right, to actually spit out the numbers and the symbols and stuff for the math problem. Now, these problems are meant to help you as far as word problems are concerned, application problems. So when you're reading a big old word problem, do you understand what's going on in the problem? Do you understand what it's asking you to do? Decreased. I just realized that this is misspelled. and that sort of thing. So that's really what the aim of these problems are meant to do. Now, sometimes they're just going to ask you to translate. Sometimes they're going to ask you to actually translate them and then solve the equation. Now, if you're asked to do the latter of the two there, and you actually have to solve these, I would just really highly emphasize practicing these type of problems over and over again. For the most part, unless you're not one of those word puzzle type of people, for the most part, these could be a little bit confusing sometimes, and it does take practice in order to understand them. And if you don't know how to translate them correctly, then any work that you would do then afterwards would be incorrect, right? So the translating portion of these problems, I would say, is the most important of it. So for these examples, we're just going to translate only. We're not going to get into solving quite yet, right? So taking a look at example A here, it says 2/3 of a number decreased by 6. Okay, so when it comes to these examples, I say take them one word at a time. 2/3, right? So here I have 2/3 of something, and it says 2/3 of a number. Now, first off, the word of, typically the word of when it comes to math is asking you to multiply. So if I want 2/3 of something, or like for example, if I want half of 50, right, that's telling me to take 50 and chop it in half, right? Or half of 100, right? So to take 100 and chop that in half. So if I want 2/3 of some number, I want to take this number and I want 2/3 of that. So of means to multiply. So what this says is I want to multiply 2/3 times some number. Now we don't know what that number is, right? It just says a number. And typically in math, if we don't know what that number is, we use x, right? We don't know what it is, so we're just gonna say that it's x. So I want 2/3 of a number, and that number is going to be x for me. So 2/3 of a number, so 2/3 of a number, and it says that this is decreased by 6. So when you look at decreased, if I want to decrease something, that means it's going lower, and that means it's going down. I want less of it, so that means subtraction. So if I want to decrease this by 6, that's saying, well, hey, I want a minus 6, right? That's kind of just a fancy, confusing math way of saying minus 6. So I want 2/3 of a number, and I want
to minus 6 from it. So 2 thirds x minus 6. And this right here is what they're looking for. This is an expression. They want you to plug this in as your answer here. So 2 thirds of a number decreased by 6. All right, so let's move on to another one and let's see maybe if that one makes any more sense. Right, so here we have 3/4 of a number decreased by 2, and it says that this is 1/5 of that number. Okay, so again, one word at a time. 3/4 of a number. So that's very similar to what we had right here. 2/3 of a number. The only difference is that this one says 3/4 of a number. So that means I'm going to take 3/4 and I'm going to multiply it by some number. Don't know what the number is, so it's going to be x. So 3/4 times x. And it says that this is going to be decreased by 2, right? Which means I want a minus 2. So I have 3/4 of a number. I want a minus 2 from it. And it says that this is. Now, when you see is, that typically means equals. And it says that this is 1/5 of that number. So 1/5 of that number. Now, what number is it talking about? It's talking about the same number that we used over here. So this is equal to 1/5 of, again, remember, of means to multiply, of that same number. The number was x. I'm going to use x over here. So 3/4 of that number decreased by 2 is the same thing as 1/5 of that number here. So 3/4 x minus 2 is equal to 1/5 x. That's how that one would translate right there.